طولا جليلا إذا الليل أرخى علينا السدولا
لك الحمد والمجد والكبرياء.
الحمد لله الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمه وعلى عفوه بعد قدرته والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم وأزواجه أمهاتهم صدق الله العظيم. Respected viewers, welcome back once again to our program The Mothers of Islam. In our previous program we spoke about and we were continuing about the life of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and undoubtedly amongst the wives of our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam it is but natural for us to spend more programs on her life comparative to anyone else. This was because of her importance, the important role she played, because of Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam's love for her, her remarkable type of life, her remarkable qualities, her attributes, which were to have played a very important and crucial role in the earlier stages of Islamic history. It also tells us that in the Islamic history, in the early stages, the role of the woman was also paramount. And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's role in that, from that we can gauge what an important role she played, which tells us that even within the modesty of Islam, women can reach great heights of knowledge, wisdom, taqwa and piety. The way Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the modesty which Islam demanded, did not prevent her from reaching such great heights in terms of her intellect, in terms of her development, in terms of her ilm, her knowledge, and even in some instances, playing a role to bring about a just cause, to bring about justice in Islam, as we will go on, especially in the program today. After making mention in our last program of her role in the time of Abu Bakr and Umar, now comes the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We know the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu can be divided into two segments. The first 6 years, there was amazing prosperity. There was peace. There was progression of Islam. The Islamic empire had reached a zenith. It had reached such great heights that on one hand, it was right up till Sindh and right up till the Central Asian Republic. And on the other hand, it had reached the furthermost west coast or the west portion of Africa. And even beyond that, it had overtaken the Persian Empire, and Syria and Asia Minor were all under the control of Islam and the Muslim. It was Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu who had established the first navy of the Muslims. This was to play a crucial role in the later development of the Islamic empire and civilization, not only amongst the Umayyads, the Abbasids, but right even up to the Ottoman Empire. In many centuries thereafter, when Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu established the navy, the Islamic navy, they controlled the Mediterranean, which was to control the major portions of the known world at that time. So Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu played a very, very great role. In the latter portion of his Khilafat, there rose a group of people who came from Abdullah ibn Sabah. We will call them, for the sake of this program, Sabais. Those people who were followers of Abdullah ibn Sabah, he comes from a very dubious background. Many people and many historians would say that he is a founder of Shiism. The Shiism emanated from Abdullah ibn Sabah. And one of the reasons why he came into the open was that the enemies of Islam could not see the progress of Islam. So when they were unable to blockade the progress of Islam from outside, they tried to bring about internal dissension and to stop the progress of Islam from within. So they accepted Islam as hypocrites, and thereafter they worked to bring about internal dissension, and they worked to implode the progress of Islam after coming from within. And many a times, as it so happens, that people will not see through their designs, and they come in apparently with a good face, They come in with noble intention, but behind it lurks very dubious motives. And so it was with Abdullah ibn Sabah. He started stirring different type of situations. He started on one hand to say Ali radiallahu anhu was more suited for the Khilafat. On one hand, he started telling people that no, Uthman radiallahu anhu is not acting with justice, and he created a rebellion. And when he created the rebellion, many people fell for that particular situation, and they fell for his propaganda. And some, even sincere Muslims, they also came into the fore with him. And I won't go into the history with regard to it. It is for a later time. But we want to speak about the role of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was to give proper answers to all the allegations. Whatever allegations they made, Uthman radiallahu anhu answered it. They came to camp outside Medina Munawwara. And amongst them was Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's brother Muhammad bin Abi Bakr. Muhammad bin Abi Bakr was a brother, maybe we can call a stepbrother, because they shared one father but different mothers. The mother of Muhammad bin Abi Bakr, subject to correction, most likely Asma bint Umays. And why I will say this, because Muhammad bin Abi Bakr was also close to Ali radiallahu anhu. And of course there is a link in this particular regard, because Asma bint Umays was married first to Hazrat Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala, thereafter married to Abu Bakr, thereafter married to Ali radiallahu ta'ala. Nevertheless, Muhammad bin Abi Bakr was also came under the influence of Ali radiallahu ta'ala in the time and Khilafat of Ali radiallahu ta'ala. But here Muhammad bin Abi Bakr was part of those people who initially they had certain complaints against Uthman. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala had given proper answers to all of those, and he had resolved the issue. Ali radiallahu anhu had mediated, and everything was resolved. And after all the aspects were resolved, they were told to go back to their places. But however, what was quite clear, they were not there for the resolving of the issues. They wanted to create dissension. They wanted to create the blockage of the progress of Islam. So they went in different ways, and they came back saying, Aliyadu billah, Uthman radiallahu anhu had gone against his agreement. And they produced a letter that was sent to the ruler of, or the governor of Egypt, that when this letter comes to you, kill the person who brings this letter to you. And the people who brought the letter were those who were destined for Basra. Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu was amongst those who had mediated the whole agreement. And when he saw them, and he said, how is it possible for people going the route of Basra for them to intercept a letter that going to Egypt? You people have come with fitna, and I know your fitna. And Uthman radiallahu anhu, on the other hand, was just a remarkable human being, a person of great dignity, a person of great piety and taqwa. To him will belong this honor. The two things that he did, one was when they approached him and said he must abdicate the Khilafat, he say, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me, oh Uthman, a time will come when people will want to abdicate, or will want you to abdicate your Khilafat, to not remove the rope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had put upon you, to not abdicate. And the second thing he said, Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, once the swords of the Ummah are drawn against one another, it will never be put back. It will always remain against one another. Once disunity comes into the Ummah, once there is fighting amongst the Ummah, it will remain till the day of judgment. And Uthman at all cost was not to prepared to be the one to lift up the sword amongst his own Muslim brothers, even if it came to the extent of him being martyred. And he remained. He was the leader of such great empires. He could not have dealt with a group of rebels who had come to make false accusations against him. How many times Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu anhu said, I will send a battalion from Syria to come and protect you against the rebels. The Sahaba, the senior Sahaba, they pleaded with Uthman, oh Uthman, allow us to take care of those rebels. And he said, no. For my sake, I will not allow the spilling of blood of the Muslims. I will die in the cause. I will die in the meanwhile. I will die in the process. But I will not allow, for my sake, peoples and Muslims and believers, blood must be spilled. And Uthman radiallahu anhu remained. And in that way, Muhammad bin Abi Bakr was part and parcel of it. This, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anhu was going for Hajj. She pleaded with her brother, come with me. I will take you for Hajj. You will get away from this fitna. But he did not listen. And And many a times people make this whole particular aspect because of this link that Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was in some way, you know, complicit. And her later role was to prove that she was not. One day, a companion of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to ask about Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. His name was Ubaidullah bin Adi. And she said, I always stood up for Uthman. I always regarded him to be one on taqwa, one on piety, a remarkable person of morality and integrity. And I never allowed, and I never wanted the dishonoring and disrespect of Uthman. If I wanted to do so, if that was my case, then may I also be disrespected. I never wanted Uthman to be killed. If that is the case, may I also be killed in the process. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala had gone for Hajj. While in Hajj, and coming back for Hajj from Hajj at a place called Sarif, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala came to know that Uthman radiallahu ta'ala had been martyred. And she was taken aback. She went back to Makkah. People thronged around her because of her status, her stature, the mother of the Ummah. They wanted to know what to do. It was a heartbreaking and tragic event in the history of Islam and the Muslims. And after the break, we will relate how Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha related two events which had transpired at that time, especially the heartbreaking and tragic event of the martyrdom of Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Respected viewers, welcome back once again to our program. Prior to the break, we were speaking about Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu's martyrdom, and a pious human being, a selfless Muslim who didn't want to spill the blood of fellow believers for his own sake. Even in the process, he had lost his life. In many ways, he was a martyr. He was a martyr par excellence. And he lost his life, and he was martyred in such a tragic way. But he remained firm that he will not be the first one. And for his sake, he didn't want the spilling of Muslim blood. It's difficult to overemphasize the magnitude of the tragic consequences of the Khalifa Uthman radiallahu anhu's assassination. It opened up the floodgates of dissension and mutual killing of Muslims till the day of judgment. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, when she came to hear about it, she was taken aback. And she came back to Makkah Mukarramah. When she came back to Makkah Mukarramah, bear in mind she was on her way and she was at Sarif. When she heard about Usman radiallahu anhu's martyrdom, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha came back to Makkah Mukarramah. She addressed the people and she told them that this is such a tragic event. We have to insist upon retaliation of those people who had taken the life of the just and pious and modest ruler, Hazrat Usman radiallahu anha. And we must bear in mind that Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha lent her support to their demand for the punishment of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu's murderers, simply because she regarded it as a just cause. And this was to prove that at that time Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhu led this particular aspect. Hazrat Talha bin and Zubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the meanwhile, had come back from Makkah. The people who had assassinated Usman radiallahu anhu, they had taken control in some way of some aspects of Medina Munawwara. And there were various people who were touted to become the next Khalifa. And when it was presented to Ali ibn Abi Talib, at first Ali ibn Abi Talib was reluctant to accept. But when he saw that what was happening to the Ummah, when he saw that they needed leadership, when he saw that the Ummah was confused, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu accepted the Khilafat. According to the Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaat, of which we are proud to belong, we believe that Ali ibn Abi Talib was the correct Khalifa at that time. And he was the most suitable person to become the Khalifa at that time. However, there was an aspect of how to deal with the people who had martyred and who had killed Hazrat Usman radiallahu anhu. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu said and told to Talha bin Zubair, who were very greatly affected, and said, that if you can find the people who are responsible, go and find them for me. But if you cannot do it and you cannot find them immediately, give me a chance to bring about peace. give me a chance to settle down things, and then we will take care of those people who have done this wrong. We will go through the process of finding out the right people. Obviously, you got to keep in mind, people's emotions were running high. And when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu sent someone to become the next governor, obviously as a Khalifa, he had the right now to appoint the governor. So when the governor was sent to Damascus, the governor was sent back and he was told that go and tell Ali this message that we want justice to be served with regard to the people who had taken the life of Uthman ibn Affan. The person came back to say that, oh Ali, I came back from Damascus. And the situation with regard to Damascus was that the cut finger of Naila, the wife of Uthman, was paraded in the mosque of Damascus, and 60,000 people were baying that justice must be served. And the people who had martyred Uthman radiallahu anhu must be brought to justice. That is how I left Damascus. Ali radiallahu anhu obviously had to establish peace. And because of that, he decided that he has to move towards Damascus, where his governor was not accepted. In the meanwhile, Hazrat Aisha, Talha and Zubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu were in Makkah Mukarramah. They also were greatly, greatly saddened by the tragic events. So it was decided amongst them, they will go to Basra. And Basra had become a major center of Islam at that time, Kufa and Basra. And they said they will go to Basra, gather support of people to be able to put pressure so that the murderers of Uthman must be brought to justice. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala only went there with the intention of sulah, reconciliation, peace and justice. How many times she was to repeat this whole particular aspect that I have not come with the intention of war. I have not come with the intention of shedding more blood. I have come that Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a person of waqar, a person of dignity, a person of such great modesty, has been killed in such a tragic circumstances in the holy month of Dhul-Hijjah when people were gone for Hajj. His killers must be brought to book. So in this way, she went towards Basra. On the way, they came to a place called Dhat-e Irak. There was a separation between the other wives of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Aisha. The other wives sought permission to be able to go back to Medina and Munawwara. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, given her keen intellect, her education, her bravery, and being the one who could sort of take things forward, she decided to carry on. There was an incident where she, at one stage, was on the verge of coming back. But when people started saying that you are the mother of the Ummah, the mother of Islam, people will listen to you. Why don't you carry on? You have to command this and you have to lead this. You have to be the one who will be able to claim and to speak on justice. Ali radiallahu anhu, when he came to know that Talha, Hazrat Zubair and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha had gone towards Basra, he changed his mind and started going towards Basra. Two of his very close family members, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Hazrat Hassan radiallahu anhu, pleaded with Ali radiallahu anhu. Hazrat Hassan said, my father, don't go. Don't go anywhere. I want you to stay in Medina. Make Medina your base. If you are going to go there, I'm afraid that matters are going to spiral beyond control and the Muslims are going to end of shedding blood of one another. And Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu listened to him, but he still felt that he has to establish himself as a Khalifa to be able to bring calm and dignity. He was in no way in agreement with what had happened with regard to Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then when he went there, this just showed how the two were now working. He sent Ka'ka ibn Amr to Hazrat Aisha, Hazrat Talha and Zubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he told them, go and resolve the matter. Ka'ka radiallahu ta'ala anhu came and he presented Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu's view that I want to bring and establish justice. And I want to establish, and I want to find the people who are responsible for the tragic killing and the murdering of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, but give me time to bring about peace and calm. They agreed. And Ka'ka ibn Amr went back to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and both of these people were extremely happy. They were saying, Alhamdulillah, through the grace of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had averted bloodshed. So in this particular way, this is what actually happened, that peace had been agreed upon. And now, when the killers of Uthman, who had joined both parties stealthily, they came to realize, if this particular aspect comes to be played out, that the peace that has been agreed upon becomes manifest, then we are in trouble. So they came upon a particular idea to bring the Muslims into war with one another. And after this, they came, and in the middle of the night, they started attacking the people who were in the, those people who were the murderers. Bear in mind, Usman Ali radiallahu anhu, when he set out to Basra, had said and told people, anyone who had been involved in the conspiracy of Uthman must not join my army. Anyone who was involved in the conspiracy of murdering Uthman must not be in my army. They had stealthily come in. They started attacking Hazrat Talha, Hazrat Zubair, and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha's army. Bear in mind, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was in Basra, and people were confused, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha had gathered the people, and she had given a very eloquent speech. In that speech, she reminded the people about herself, about Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anha, and said, I have not come here with any intention of creating war or creating dissension. I want to reconcile people. This tragic event that have happened, these people who were the ones who had killed Uthman radiallahu anhu, were in some way, in some form of control in Medina and Munawwara, we have to bring an end to it. I have come with the intention of supporting a just cause and to reconcile the Muslims and bring them back again to the way of the earlier Khalifas and the time of our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was so eloquent in speech that she changed the entire situation in Basra. The governor of Basra, appointed by Ali radiallahu anhu, tried to resist, but her eloquence was such that people joined her army. Ali radiallahu anhu, when he left Medina, many of the people did not join him because they didn't want to see bloodshed. They didn't want to see Muslim joining Muslim. So many of the seniors, ashab and companions, they remained in Medina and Munawwara. They didn't want to partake in this whole thing. So Ali radiallahu anhu gathered support from Kufa. So in many ways, Ali radiallahu anhu's army had many people from Kufa and some from Medina and Munawwara. And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anhu, Talha and Zubair radiallahu anhu had many Muslims from Makkah and from Basra. Bear in mind, Hazrat Ka'ka ibn Amr had brought them together and had agreed upon a peace. But how could the enemies of Islam, how could the Sabais ever agree upon seeing this? They wanted the war to carry on. So what they did was, they brought about such a situation where on one hand, they attacked the army of Ali radiallahu anhu, on the other hand, they attacked the army of Hazrat Aisha, Talha and Zubair radiallahu anhu. And when these great people who had just agreed upon a formula for a peaceful agreement on the matters that was a matter of difference of opinion amongst them, they came to realize in the morning that one army has attacked the other army. They were surprised. And when they tried to resolve and tried to stop it, it was beyond their control. And because of this, things spiraled beyond control due to the munafiqat and the hypocrisy of the Sabais. And this particular battle started. And one of the greatest tragedies of history is not when truth confronts falsehood. One of the greatest tragedies of history is when truth confronts with truth. And here was a situation where people, both sides were sincere people. Both sides wanted justice. Both sides wanted good. But unfortunately, it turned out that they started fighting with one another. Hazrat Zubair radiallahu anhu came across Ali radiallahu anhu and said, and Ali radiallahu anhu said, oh Zubair, do you remember that Nabi Karim sallallahu one day told you that you will come up against me and you would be on the wrong? And Zubair radiallahu anhu remembered this and he withdrew from the battle. On the way, a munafiq and a hypocrite by the name of Amr bin Jarmuz followed him and killed him, thinking that Ali radiallahu anhu was fighting against him, he would be happy to see the head of Zubair. But when Ali radiallahu anhu saw the head of Zubair and told Amr bin Jamuz, you are going into the fire of Jahannam, how could you kill Zubair? And then he took the sword of Zubair and he started crying. And he said, this sword used to protect the Nabi of Allah. The sword used to bring glee on the face of the Nabi of Allah. Afterwards, he was to send that sword to Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anhu. Talha bin Ubaidullah also withdrew, and thereafter he also was killed. And then the whole battle became known as the Battle of the Camel, because Aisha radiallahu anha, she was in the battlefield. She remained and she said, we have only come to demand justice for the people who had killed Uthman radiallahu anhu. She had taken a stand. She has taken wanting justice. And when people surrounded her all the time. Now, bearing in mind, she was a mother of Islam, the mother of the Ummah. So when people thought that maybe, perhaps she might be at peril, everyone surrounded the camel of Aisha radiallahu anhu to see that she is not harmed. When Ali radiallahu anhu understood the situation, he told his people and said, the camel of Aisha had become the focal point of the battle. If you disable the camel, then the fight will come to an end. He sent a group of people to be able to disable the camel. When the camel was disabled and it came thud down upon the ground, the entire battle came to an end. And what was amazing was, Ali came to Aisha and said, oh my mother, how are you? May Allah forgive you. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, oh Ali, may Allah forgive you. And how are you? This is how the battle of the camel, of which Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha played a prominent role for the reasons mentioned. Obviously, in later years, she was to regret this and she used to cry that I never ever thought when I left Makkah that this is going to happen. I had left with the intention of bringing the Ummah together to bring about justice. Never in my wildest dream did I imagine that this was going to happen. It was one of the great tragedies of our history. Unfortunately, time has come up. And inshallah, in our next program, we will continue from here on the life of the remarkable woman, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. وآخر دعوانا عن الحمد لله رب العالمين
دعوني أناجي مولى جليلا إذا الليل أرخى علي السدولا نظرت إليك بقلب ذليل لأرجو به يا إلهي